Good morning, and welcome to Trinity United Church of Christ. Whoever you are and wherever you are on life's journey, you are welcome here. Well, we have another rainy Sunday morning, but I will point out that it is not snow, so we're appreciative of the rain. Just a couple quick announcements from me before we begin. During this extended season of Easter, we are sharing communion every Sunday. Our communion table is open to all. There are packets of bread and little cups of juice out in the hallway outside this entrance. If you didn't pick one up, you'll want to do that. And if you're watching from home, this would be a good time to prepare a piece of bread of any kind and a beverage of any kind so you can join us for communion. Now, we're always color-coded, but it changes every time. So for this week, if you need gluten-free bread, it should have a light pink napkin in with the bread. If your napkin is dark pink, also known as magenta, then that is regular bread, which does contain gluten. So if you have a magenta napkin and you want gluten-free bread, you would need to switch those before it comes time for communion. I was in touch yesterday with Pam Cornell, who was the director of Christian education here many years ago. Some of you remember Pam, and she has attended some of the women's retreats. Pam let me know that her husband passed away last week, so she will be in our prayers today as well. And I believe Larry has some announcements for us.
Good morning. Here are the announcements. We are accepting applications for memorial scholarships. Scholarships are available for Trinity members who are attending an accredited college or university. Applications are available in the church office and are due on June 14th. The Trinity Women's Retreat is scheduled for Saturday, June 11th. The day will be filled with food, fun, crafts, and reconnecting. The fee is $25, and please return your registration form by May 29th. I believe that's next week. Trinity in the Community is collecting items for refugees who are new to our community. A list of needed items is available on the table where you found your worship bulletin, just outside the sanctuary here. And our annual meeting is on June 12th, following worship. Reports from all Trinity groups and committees are due in the church office by Wednesday, June 1st, to be included, that is to be included in the report. And that is my announcements. Thank you. Our scripture today comes from the book of John, chapter 5, verses 1 through 9. After there was a festival of the Jews, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem. Now in Jerusalem, by the sheep gate, there is a pool called the Hebrew Bethzatha, which has five porticoes. In these lay many ill, blind, lame, and paralyzed people. One man was there who had been ill for 38 years. When Jesus saw him lying there and knew that he had been there a long time, he said to him, "Do you want to be made well?" The ill man answered him, "Sir, I have no one to put me into the pool when the water is stirred up. And while I am making my way, someone else steps down ahead of me." Jesus said to him, "Stand up, take your mat, and walk." At once the man was made well, and he took up his mat and began to walk. Now that day was the Sabbath. This ends the reading of God's word.
Thank you.
I have to tell you that tomorrow is the 35th wedding anniversary for Janice and me, and I think the happiest moment of our marriage for her is when she gets to come up and say, "Mute yourself." Let's pray together for just a moment. Holy God, you designed us to heal ourselves from many problems and illnesses and diseases, but sometimes our healing abilities alone are not enough. And we turn to many different sources for healing. Today, let us look at the kind of healing that can come through faith because of the promises you gave us in the new covenant, represented by the cup of communion. Amen. Well, this week I was doing a little lame research and I watched some videos about faith healers. There's one pastor in particular, I won't use his name, but he's famous for a couple things. One is that he announced that he needed a new supersized jet for his ministry, because if you have to fly in a commercial airplane, you're essentially in a metal tube full of demons. And so you can't fly commercial, you have to have your own jet. So I'll be sending a bill to each of you for your fair share of my jet. Maybe not. This same preacher was talking about how the Spirit moves him when people come to be healed. Of course, it's a very elaborate ceremony, and they come forward, and the Spirit tells him what each one needs. And he proudly talked about one man who was coming forward, and the Spirit said, "Punch him in the stomach as hard as you can." And he said, "Lord, I would never do such a thing to someone." And the Spirit said, "No, punch him in the stomach as hard as you can." So being an obedient Christian, that's what he did. And amazingly, the man's intestinal problems were fixed. Another man came forward, and God said, "Spit in his eyes." He said, "Spit in his eyes?" And so he did. And it turns out, you'll never believe this, the man had a problem with his vision. And because it was the DNA of the Spirit in the spit, he cured him. Are you buying any of this? It's an amazing thing. Well, if you are a believer in faith healing, you might be in the wrong place. What you need to do is get in your car and drive north on Main Street. Starting at our church, it's just 2.5 miles to Grace Cathedral. The round building was originally built in 1958 by Rex Humbard, and it was called the Cathedral of Tomorrow. After Rex Humbard moved to Florida, the building was purchased by the late Reverend Ernest Angley, who passed away a year ago this month at the age of 99. Now, Reverend Angley was known as a faith healer, and people would come to his healing services to have their medical problems fixed by the work of the Holy Spirit. And you could watch these televised services and see Reverend Angley restore people's hearing or make them able to walk without their cane or crutches or wheelchair. So I was curious about what's happening now that Reverend Angley has gone to the great beyond, and I looked at their webpage, and here's what it says about healing. "We believe in good doctors, nurses, medicines, and hospitals. We believe that God uses many methods to heal, and that all healing comes from God. The Bible tells us, Bible quote number one, with his stripes, Christ's stripes, we are healed," from Isaiah 53:5. "We believe it's God's will for people to be healed. Christ had a healing ministry, and he healed all manner of sicknesses and diseases while he was here on earth." And now we're coming to Bible quote number two. "Jesus said, believers shall lay hands on the sick, and they shall recover," from Mark 16, verse 18. And we believe that promise still holds true today. So it sounds good, doesn't it, when you hear that paragraph from their webpage? Now, our faith tradition takes a slightly different approach. We kind of frown upon taking a single verse or a part of a verse out of context to support our theology. So let's take a quick look at these verses that they mentioned, that were mentioned by our friends to the north, we'll call them. So Isaiah 53, I can't read just the small snippet of verse 5 by itself, so listen to what this says. And it'll sound a little familiar because it's often read at Christmas time or at Easter. He was despised and rejected by others, a man of suffering and acquainted with infirmity, and as one from whom others hide their faces, he was despised, and we held him of no account. Surely he has borne our infirmities and carried our diseases, yet we accounted him stricken, struck down by God, and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions, crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the punishment that made us whole, and by his bruises we are healed. All we like sheep have gone astray. That should sound familiar from Handel's Messiah. We have all turned to our own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. He was oppressed and he was afflicted, yet he did not open his mouth. Like a lamb that is led to the slaughter, and like a lamb that before its shearers is silent, so he did not open his mouth. By a perversion of justice he was taken away. Who could have imagined his future? For he was cut off from the land of the living, stricken for the transgression of my people. They made his grave with the wicked and his tomb with the rich, although he had done no violence and there was no deceit in his mouth. Now that's the whole part from Isaiah. The book of Isaiah is believed by both Christian and Jewish scholars to have two different authors. All of the book after chapter 40 was most likely written during the time that the people of Israel were exiled in Babylon. Hebrew scholars say that Isaiah 53 is about the suffering of the nation of Israel personified as one man. Now, Christians say this passage is a prophetic prediction of the new King David, the Messiah, who will come in the future and who will take on the suffering for all of mankind's transgressions. And it's certainly possible to align this passage with the life of Jesus. That is, he may be the best match for what Isaiah wrote. Well, getting back to Grace Cathedral, they also quote part of a verse from Mark 16. Now, you may remember we talked shortly after Easter that the oldest existing copies of the Gospel of Mark end at chapter 16, verse 8. You remember that part says, the women encountered an angel who told them that Jesus was raised from the dead. They left the empty tomb, and they were terrified and told no one what they had seen. And of course, that felt unfinished because clearly people heard that Jesus was no longer dead. Now, the longer ending was added early in the second century AD, that is about 100 years after Jesus lived. The last time we talked about this longer ending, I mentioned that it contains some unusual content that's not repeated anywhere else in the Bible. So for this part, we've got to read verses 15 through 19, or through 18. And Jesus said to them, go into all the world and proclaim the good news to the whole creation. So that's the Great Commission, we recognize that. The one who believes and is baptized will be saved, but the one who does not believe will be condemned. Now, here's the verse. And these signs will accompany those who believe. By using my name, they will cast out demons. They will speak in new tongues. They will pick up snakes. And if they drink any deadly thing, some versions say any poison, it will not hurt them. They will lay their hands on the sick and they will recover. Well, that's some interesting content. These verses are often cited by our Pentecostal siblings in Christ. And I love all of you, but I draw the line at proving my faith by picking up poisonous snakes or drinking poison. I'm happy to pray for healing, even for demons to leave, but if you need healing that requires me to handle snakes or drink poison, I would recommend that you keep your appointment with your regular doctor instead. Well, today we're reading from the Gospel of John. Jerusalem, you'll remember, was a walled city. There were big walls all around it. The walls are still there, but the city has expanded far beyond them. Along the east side of the city, just north of the temple complex, was a gate called the Sheep Gate. It was also known as the Lion Gate. I guess that's a nice Christian connection. The lion and the lamb can both go through that gate. I don't know. It was interesting that the city of Jerusalem had different numbers of gates at different times. Sometimes a gate would be walled off. Sometimes a new gate would be made. There were about 12 gates in all. So they believed that because there was plentiful water near this area, sheep were brought in through this gate to drink. Now, just inside the gate was a pool of water. Actually, there were two pools together. Now, to understand this, you have to understand a little bit about Jewish culture. Jewish law required people to bathe in moving water to purify themselves. The Hebrew word is mikvah. The most common use was women after their menstrual cycle would bathe to ritually purify themselves, and it had to be done in water that was moving. It couldn't be stagnant water. So at this place, the more commonly heard name is the Pool of Bethesda, there were actually two pools, one larger that was a reservoir, and one smaller, a little lower, and so they could open an opening in the large pool, the water would flow into the small pool and out a drain, creating moving water, which could be used for ritual bathing. Now, according to legend, this particular pool had a miraculous ability that sometimes, not always, but sometimes, the first person to enter the water when it moved would be healed. So many people who had a variety of health problems clustered around this pool, hoping to be the first one in the fresh moving water. Now Jesus learned that this one particular man had been paralyzed for 38 years, and he stayed by this pool every day, but each time the water moved, other people crowded in, and he couldn't get himself into the pool to be healed. Can you imagine the frustration of that? You're there every day. You're ready. But just when the water moves, somebody else jumps in ahead of you. And of course, if somebody got in to help him down, they would have been the first person in the pool, so it wouldn't have worked. So Jesus just asked him a question. Do you want to be made well? Now the man explains why it is that he can't get into the water. But Jesus says to him, stand up and take up your mat and walk. And immediately that man was able to get up and walk. You see, getting into the water only offered a small hope of being healed. But the success rate for Jesus was 100%. He knew that this man had perseverance, patience, and faith. So Jesus approached him with compassion and kindness, and the healing happened right away. Jesus didn't touch him, didn't punch him in the stomach, didn't spit in his face. He just said words. He just said, get up, pick up your mat, and walk. The healing restored him completely, and he was able to go back to his community and live a normal life. Well, friends, we are connected to Christ through the sacraments of baptism and communion. We are sealed and marked as belonging to God. Each time we share communion, we take a bit of Christ into ourselves, and we share the new covenant that's present in the blood of Christ. Part of that new covenant is the freedom to heal. Our bodies are designed to be self-healing, and we can overcome many things, but sometimes we require advanced medical procedures or surgery to recover. And sometimes healing is not meant for us, but we can still be comforted and given the gift of peace during times of suffering. So this week I have a challenge for you. I want you to think of one person you know who needs healing. Take maybe 5 minutes to pray for that person each day. You might be moved to call them or to visit or to send a card or to share a meal. Follow whatever you're led to do and see what happens. I promise that they'll be blessed, but also you will be blessed in the process. Amen. Our next hymn is one that we're not 100% familiar with, but I think it's easy to sing, and we'll pick up on it as we go. It's called Arise, My Soul, Arise, and we can also arise in body to sing the hymn together.
With confidence I now draw nigh, with confidence.
may be seated. We'll begin our time of prayer with prayer requests, so I'll come out and hear what prayer requests we have. We are praying for Pam Cornell and her family. Her husband went in the hospital for heart surgery and ended up spending 3 months in the hospital and ultimately passed away. Yes. Okay. Waiting for results. Yeah, okay. Prayers for Vanessa, who had MRIs and is waiting for the results. Oh, has it coming this Saturday? Okay. So the last tests were all great, and we're counting on them to be great again. Who else do we want to pray for? I want to remember my mother today. This was her birthday, so she's in our thoughts. We have some members of our church who are traveling on some pretty epic vacations, so we hope that those work out well and that they come back rested and refreshed. We want to say hi to Liz, who's with us today. Who else do we want to pray for? We should probably pray for Sandy's neighbor to overcome any negativity that may have gone in that direction this week. Yes. Okay. Okay. For Ruth's great-grandson, Griffin, who's being dedicated today in church in Minnesota. Wonderful. Yes. Oh. Renee? Already? Okay. Judy's granddaughter, Renee, is graduating, so that's a wonderful thing, from high school. Which can't happen because she was only like this big when I met her, so. Huh. All right, anybody else? Let's take a moment to pray silently, and then I'll pray, and then we'll all pray the Lord's Prayer together. Holy God, we know you as love, and your heavenly healing light shines upon us. We are your hands and feet in the world, and we can go out from this place with a healing touch. The touch may not always bring a complete cure, as happened in the time of Jesus, but it always makes a difference. During these last years of pandemic, we have been limited in how much we can touch one another, and that has been a difficulty for so many. Come into this church as we enter a time of making some necessary repairs, being good stewards of the gifts we have been given. We're always looking for the best ways to solve issues that come up with a building and with our congregation. Hold us close to your loving arms. Bless us in all that we say and do, and lead us on the right path, one step at a time. We ask all of this in the name of Jesus, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Even now, even today, God is calling us to rise up to new things. As faithful followers, we are called to be generous with the resources we are given. Although we're not passing an offering plate, there's one here near the exit, and we do invite you to place your donation there before you leave today if you wish to do so. Let's sing together the doxology.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above the heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen.
Let us pray. Lord Jesus, teach us to be generous. Teach us to serve you as you deserve, to give and not to count the cost, to toil and not to seek for rest, to labor and not to seek reward, except that of knowing that we do your will. Amen. Well, I invite you to take out the communion insert in your bulletin. If you have a large print bulletin, it's on the last page. This table reminds us of the many times that Jesus gathered with people around tables, sharing food and drink and discussing ideas. Come to the table today. It's a place of restoration and renewal. It's a place to connect with our God. Will you let go of all that holds you back from joy? Let us pray together our prayer of confession. Jesus, our host and companion, we yearn for communion with you. We yearn for the hope of new life. We yearn to meet you here. And yet we find ourselves stumbling on the way, held back by the things we have done and left undone, the things we have said and left unsaid. Forgive us. Hear now in the silence the confessions of your people. Hear the good news. All the prophets testify about him that everyone who believes in him receives forgiveness of sins through his name. In the name of the risen Christ, you are forgiven. Glory be to God. Amen. And now let's join together in our great prayer of thanksgiving. The Lord is with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your voices to tell of this great love.
We lift them up in joyful praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing to give thanks to you, O living God. Time after time you draw us here to inspire us, feed us, and save us. When our love fails, you are still here, steadfast and true. You created this world and called it good. You created us to proclaim your goodness to all, and so we raise our voices together in praise. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. We remember the life and ministry of Jesus. He healed the sick, fed the hungry, ate with sinners, and preached forgiveness and peace. It was at a table like this that he issued the invitation to gather together, to share together, and to remember together. He told us to go and do likewise in the world. Jesus, Lamb of God, worthy is your name. This is the bread of the earth, received from the fields. It will set you free. This bread of life I will take up, and I will call on the name of God.
Jesus,
Lamb of God, worthy is your name. This is the cup given of the earth, received from the vine. It will set you free. The cup of freedom I will take up, and I will call on the name of the Lord. Jesus, Lamb of God, worthy is your name. And so we raise our voices to proclaim together the timeless truth. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
Amen.
Amen. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us, your people, and on these gifts of bread and cup. Make us lovers of your word. Make us people who continue to tell the story. Make us healers and teach us to spread your grace. Make us one body in Jesus Christ. This bread is the body of Christ. In remembrance of him, take and eat. This cup is the new covenant in the blood of Christ. In remembrance of him, take and drink. Let us join together in our prayer after communion. Holy One, together at this table, we have seen the Christ among us. Through this sacrament, renew and refresh us for the work you call us to do. Lift us up when we fall, and give us strength. Breathe your Spirit on us, and send us into the world, free to sing and shout and praise your name. Amen. I invite you to stand if you wish, and let's sing together our final hymn, I Will Sing of My Redeemer. On the cross, May the God of grace lead us to live in harmony with one another, in accord with Christ Jesus, that together we may glorify God with one voice as followers of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen.
You hold my every moment, you calm my raging seas, you walk with me through fire and heal all my disease. I trust in you, I believe you're my healer, I believe you. You hold my world in-